have oh, hey, what's up? We're going, I think. JLP will be on Owen Schroyer today. That's cool. Isn't it cool? Owen Schroyer. That's a band.video. So check it out.
At
3 p.m. Pacific time, 5 Central, 6 Eastern.
I forgot to mention it.
JLP forgot to mention it. Nice.
Thank you, Hake.
You're welcome. Bum, 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 bum. Yep. All right. So we're off, guys. It is 9 o'clock here in Los Angeles, Thursday, April 4th, AD 2024. And that means Men's Forum, because it's the first Thursday of the month, 7 p.m. at Bond in Los Angeles. Very special episode of Joel Friday TV coming up right after Hake. So make sure you check that out. The 100th episode of Joel Friday TV on YouTube. And on IG, Instagram. And of course, American Anchor Baby happening after that. It's his last show of the week, Joel Friday TVs, because he's not live on Friday. what will we cover today? We'll see what we get to. I wanted to talk a little bit about insanity, because it's like a scary notion, insanity, for some people, I think. I think maybe a lot of people are scared of that notion, if they are fear that it's true of them, that they are insane. And so I want to see if I can or can't. You're welcome to call in and agree or disagree with me or elaborate with your insight on what it is. I think it's simple what it is. American Anchor Baby kind of covered it yesterday with the depressed people. The depression app. Rejoin. There's an app for it. Prescription app. I will get to your super chats as well, guys. What else? There was something else I wanted to cover. Oh, the Bible, maybe. There were some things, topics that I didn't get to yesterday that I wanted to get to. So hopefully today, if not Friday, I don't have any guests planned this week, okay? I would like to get back to getting guests, but we'll see. Federal judges pretending like they're on Christian's side, but only when the Christians are doing something liberal. It's ridiculous. Like feeding the poor, feeding the so-called hungry, freeing the illegal aliens. I may cover evil Obama as well. I've talked about him already this week, but I didn't play the clip of him. So anyway, guys, and some beautiful music. Well, fun music for Hake anyway. Anyway, guys, let's get right on with the show!
1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, it's the Hake Report, the Hake Report, la la la.
How you guys doing? I am fine. Somebody asks, Hake, how many channels do you have? Well, if you go to thehakereport.com, you can find out, because I pretty much list almost everything that I have. I have YouTube, Rumble, DLive, Facebook, IG, and it's all The Hake Report, okay? X, Twitch, Kick, Odyssey, BitChute. BitChute is not live, but it's uploads right after. It's 10 channels, 10 video platform channels. There may be something else like Gab, gab.com/maybe James Anton Hake. James Anton Hake. So nice, huh? TheHakeReport.com. Let me see. Hake? Cool website, Hake. Thank you. TheHakeReport.com. Let me check that out. Oh, yeah. Sweet. Okay. Yeah, I'm wearing a brown shirt, just so you know, whatever. Not that you needed to know that, but it's a Route 66. It's a famous highway or a road or something. Historic Route 66, Santa Monica, California t-shirt. 100% cotton. Size medium. Not Nazi. Oh, yeah. Not the Nazi-type brown shirts. I forgot about that. I never really knew about it, to be honest. So, a few tips, guys. A few tips. The NAACP, you know, National Association Against Colored People. They hate black people. Of course, they hate white people, too, of course, right? They posted on X, disgusted, not surprised. I don't have a screenshot of it or a video of it anyway, but they're quote tweeting a 14-second video of our greatest president, Trump, saying, what did he say? Something about, he's at a rally, BCF, remarks, Trump delivers remarks, quote tweeting, highbrow underscore nobrow, Trump, would you rather have the black president, capital B, or the white president? I think they want the white guy. And he's quote tweeting a video from black conservative something, 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 where Trump is speaking. And maybe it's talking about how Obama was evil and only brought evil upon the blacks, increasing black on black crime through supporting Black Lives Matter and fake ideas of racism and stuff like that. Whereas Trump brought peace and love and truth to the blacks, although he was maybe a little bit too over-gracious, my opinion. I think they want the white guy. And so, of course, the NAACP is disgusted, but not surprised. So that's one quick tip. Citizen Free Press said shared a video of Karl Rove saying, wants everyone at January 6th to be thrown in jail. I don't know what he means exactly. He says, every one of those B-words who did that, we ought to find them, try them, and send them to jail. Karl Rove was responsible for getting George W. Bush in office, kind of. Or he was a very, very big, I don't know, establishment guy. And he hates Trump and Trump supporters and independent thinkers and Tea Party people. And he's a lame guy. A rhino, even though he's never held office. Fat, by the way. He always used to appear on Fox News, and he would have like a whiteboard thing. A vicious person. People were mad at him for Swift boating? Swift something boating? One of the vice presidential candidates or presidential candidates? Was it Al Gore or somebody? So he hates the January 6ers, the people who protested for the Trump's election in 2020. The people who showed up at January 6th. Mostly peaceful protesters. Some of them got out of hand. But they are cracking down hard on those guys. And some of them don't really deserve it. But knowing that the establishment, both sides, hates you and nobody really cares about you, best to stay away. A lot of people learned lessons from those things. Charlottesville. Best to stay away from Unite the Right rally from 2017. The hard hand of the evil fake law comes down extra hard on the whites, the independent thinkers, the Trump supporters, the Christians. So just know that they're full of hate. Don't hate back, but... And another quick little tip. Bad English from real Candace O. A journalist informed me that someone behind the scenes was attempting to shop a story trying to correlate me to Nick Fuentes. This week, that same journalist informed me that the same person is now trying to shop a story to correlate me to Milo Yiannopoulos. I don't know if you're familiar with any of these names. Nick Fuentes was on the Jesse Lee Peterson show. Milo was on the Jesse Lee Peterson show. And this other gal is a black mouth. A black big mouth gal. But I don't think that correlate is the right word. She must be black. Correlate is not the right word. Miss or Mrs. whatever your last name is supposed to be that you didn't take? Correlate? Connect, you mean. Correlate indicates that when you have similar patterns, or you, I don't know, you go in similar directions, or you, this happens and then this also happens. Correlation. I don't think that that's, I'm pretty sure that's not a correct use of the word. Just a little side note. I'm surprised at her because she doesn't seem that black that she would misuse a word like that. I'm shaking my head. But anyway, we wish her well. Journalists. Scum of the earth. But they're people. Okay, so let's talk about insanity. You can call in 1-888. She took her husband's name. Stop, says TERRI. She did? Then how come she's still known as Owens? She could get people used to using her name, her real name. But no, she doesn't. She didn't take, if she took her, hard-hitting stuff here, Hake. If she took her husband's name, why don't we know her husband's name? Why don't I know it? Not that I don't even know the stuff that she says. If she took her husband's name, then she would keep her, make her stage name. This is basically her stage name now, her husband's name. Or did she marry an Owens? Don't make me call in, says TERRI. You can call in. 1-888-775-3773. All right, so insanity. I've called a couple of people insane. And I've referred to myself a little bit insane too. And I've talked with ladies over the years, called them crazy. And some of them are like, stop calling me crazy. Stop it. Don't do that. And some of them, it's kind of personal because their mothers are insane or, you know, really, really even acknowledged by the evil world to be mentally ill, so-called, that word. I don't like that word, mentally ill. And I called Frederick Rika insane, and he's kind of remarked about that on the American Anchor Babies chat, I think. And then I've had calls from people who just seem off. And what I think that it is, what insanity I think is, one is believing stuff that's not true. Two is chasing stuff that doesn't matter. You know, even with mentally chasing something that doesn't matter. Getting hung up on a point. You know, like they say that the autistic people hyper-focus on something. Like Greta Thunberg. She is hyper-focused on the climate propaganda. Climate change propaganda that she believes. Which I believe it too, for the sake of my channels. But she's chasing that thing, and it doesn't matter. At least not to where she needs to be worried, so worried about it. They brainwash the kids to be mentally ill. They have climate anxiety. That's, in other words, insanity. They're driving the kids insane. But I think the kids were already primed to be insane or already insane by their bad parents. Insanity is being caught up. You know how you get caught up? With some kick or some point or some thing that just fascinates you too much. I say too much, that's a weasel word. That just it's just caught up. I say this because this is just simple. It's not like a mysterious, complicated. They say, oh, everybody does that. It has to be extreme. And there are extreme cases, of course, but I don't think it has to be extreme. People say, oh, narcissism personality disorder. You know, the psychologists, the psycho people. They're like, oh, it describes everybody probably, you know? Everybody's selfish. Oh, no, but it has to be extreme for you to be diagnosed with it. But everybody has that issue of selfishness, the fake notion of self where you've chased stuff for self and it makes you more miserable. Whereas if you just live right, if you know what I mean, or even if you don't know what I mean, you just live right, it goes better for you and you're happier anyway, you're more at peace and joyful and stuff. You naturally get the right amount of pleasure, the right amount of pain, the right amount of rest. It reminds me of a Bible verse that says God gives, this is probably not the right translation, but it's a paraphrase, and I think it's correct. God gives good sleep to the godly. Isn't that nice? And you can think about it, what makes you not have good sleep. Worry. That's against what Jesus said. Jesus said, do not worry or even think about your life. Chasing after drinking and just all kinds of various vices and getting caught up with stuff and then ignoring your body, and then your body has to either go to sleep or go to the bathroom or whatever. Stuff like that. Those are like insanity, but God gives good sleep. Isn't that nice? I think it says that. He says, I'll give you rest anyway. I think it's true. Thoughts can mess with your sleep, says Nikki from Texas. Mental health industrial complex is rich. XCVIII. Which, what does that mean? I was wondering. Is this Hake's insanity? XC sounds like 90. VII sounds like 98. Or is it XC cross country? X is in cross. C is in country. 8. I don't know my Roman numerals. The devil in your dreams. Yeah, people have no peace. So, my point is just to say, if I call you insane, is because I'm just saying that you're caught up. Whether it's you're a flat earther and you're caught up in harping on that. I think even if you just simply believe in flat earth stuff, I think that's an insanity sign, but there's also people who are just caught up with it, and that's a whole nother level of insanity because you're caught up with it. If you're a flat earther, and there are flat earthers who can school me on various issues, because they're more insane than me. You know, it's not good to compare anyway. You can learn stuff from a flat earther or from a felon. I've had people poo-poo great points from, like, our resident historian smearing the guy as, like, a criminal or something like that. I'm like, okay, you can learn true things from criminals, don't you know? It's called an ad hominem. That's insane. I support ad hominems, but ad hominems for Christ, for what's right, you know? So, that's all I mean. Believing something that's not true. And shout out to the Baltards. Baltards looking down on the flat earthers. Flat earthers looking down on the Baltards. Looking down on somebody, that's insane. Hopefully that's simple enough. Let me get to TERRI in Oregon, who's on the line. TERRI, have you called Hake's show before?
No. Hi.
Hey, your first time calling. Thanks for calling.
Thank you for taking my call, Hake.
Of course.
Yeah. So I wanted to ask you your opinion, or maybe go in deeper about, like, the Candace Owens name thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I
what's
I
her name then?
Her name is Farmer.
Farmer? See, what a nice name, Candace Farmer. Why don't we know this?
I mean, we do know it if you know anything about her.
Oh, yeah. I don't know anything. I really don't know much about her at all. I know that she was red pill black. And that's all I know.
Red pill black. Is that like an old name she had?
See, you don't know anything about her.
I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah, that was her name. She started to become like, quote unquote, red pilled, meaning she found out that the media was lying or something like that, or deceiving. And so she found out that, no, actually, this racism stuff is dumb. And so, so for those who don't know, like Hake, she used to be a black liberal. According to some people, she used to have a website that doxed conservatives, meaning they got she got personal info on conservatives for vindictive reasons. That's the impression that I get from what people say about her. I don't know if that's true. And then she became this darling woman in the media among the normie conservative people, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
She got these shows on like Daily Wire and stuff, and then she got herself banned because she speaks her mind very some might call it arrogantly, which I think would be fair, but she speaks what she thinks is important to say, and so she gets herself in trouble.
Yeah, I think we all can relate to that a little bit.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I don't know much about her history, so this is interesting to know that about her.
She married a British man, a white man, and then she had a child in wedlock, and did she become a stay-at-home mother and wife? No. She's still running her mouth on an ego trip, trying to be a talk show host.
It's a mess, I know.
Yeah. So anyway, she did change her name, though. That's your point of view.
She did legally change her name.
Okay.
Yeah, but I wanted your opinion about if a woman is in a position where she has established like a media presence or she has a business model that is based on her name, like, or if she's incredibly famous, like a star, let's say she's a, well-known established name. Even if she legally changes her name, do you think she should professionally change her name?
Yeah.
Mm.
I could be wrong. I'm saying yeah, because just for the sake of conversation. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't have a huge, strong opinion on this, but I mean, she shouldn't even be in the public eye anyway, in my opinion. She should be humble and a woman, and then she'd be happier that way. And everybody else would be too. think about Bruce Jenner. You search Bruce Jenner on the internet on this totally useless website called Google, hat tip to Anchor Baby. And it auto changes it to Caitlyn Jenner, you know? So maybe I'm going to get suspended or banned for dead naming Bruce. But, and hat tip to him, I like him. Or hat tip to that person, I like that person. Not like that. People would get used to it, you know? You can force people to realize. It's kind of like Twitter becoming X. I'm not used to it, but that's bold. And she's apparently not as bold as she pretends to be.
Yeah,
Elon Musk is bold to change Twitter to X. Why can't Candace Farmer, I'm going to call her Candace Farmer now, be bold enough to change her stage name to Farmer?
I mean, I don't know. What I figured out from it was that it would just be a pain to like legally and to change all of the business stuff to a new name.
Yeah.
Because it's more like it's work and money and cost.
And effort. And she doesn't want to do, she wants to work, but she doesn't want to work that hard.
Well, she's a working mother. She's a modern woman trying to have it all.
Right. if she were really trying to have it all, she'd go full Candace Farmer.
Yeah,
it's kind of like Chrissy Legend. She still goes by Chrissy Teigen. Teigen. I think it's actually Teigen. But she's too nice to even correct people and say it's Teigen. It's not Teigen. But her last name should be Legend. Or John, whatever John Legend's real last name is.
Is that his real name?
No. Yeah.
No, maybe they did it that way.
Stevens. John Roger Stevens. She should be Chrissy Roger Stevens.
Well, maybe she is legally.
Yeah. That's terrible. That's a bad example. A lot of women who are so-called professionals. This is maybe Hake's insanity because it's just a dumb topic. But a lot of professional women, like, they change their maiden last name to be their middle name. Like Amy Barrett.
I think that's weird.
Yeah, Amy Coney Barrett. The only reason I understand it is for back when Facebook was relevant, you would say you search for a female friend of yours from high school on the internet or on Facebook. Mm-hmm. You could find it because they kept that last name and turned it into a middle name. But it should be like a parentheses. How do you pronounce N-E-E? Nay? Nee? Born?
I don't know.
Born Teigen.
I'm not sure.
Born Owens. So.
Anyway. I mean, I think that's not a bad idea. I don't understand why she's going as hard as she is, like, with her employment. I don't know what her husband does. I don't know what kind of arrangement they have. I don't know if she's the breadwinner and he's not. It sounds like.
I think he's rich. Isn't he rich?
I hear he's from a rich family, but that doesn't mean he has access to his family's money.
True. You think it's one of those families? I kind of doubt it. But,
I think they might be. That's my suspicion. I don't know for sure, though. But either way, I just wanted to go kind of elaborate, like, what should a woman do in this position? You know, when you're in the public eye and you have all this business stuff, it does seem like it is kind of a pain to change everything around. If you've already established a name for yourself and her husband is less famous than her. So I don't know.
True.
What the right thing to do was in her position, but I did watch an episode of her once where she said that she has legally changed her name because she did get that backlash about it. So.
Oh, that's why? She addressed it.
No, she did it. She did it.
She did it before the backlash, but she.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So she had petty haters like Hake.
Yes.
And then she had to address it. That's funny.
So you're not the only one out there that's angry at her.
Of course not. Yeah.
Not being a traditional woman. So.
Right. What do you think about the fact that she is still trying to be a host?
I mean, I don't know. Like, I don't know enough about her life or how it's set up to, I think, have a really strong judgment. I know if I were in her position, you know, a mother with three small children, I would not want to be working how she does.
She has three children already?
Yeah.
Did she have triplets? Or she had one after the other after the other?
She's having them one after the other, I think.
Wow,
good for
her. I mean, good for her, but that's wild. I had no idea she had three children already.
Half-white babies.
Go ahead.
You know?
Sorry?
It sounds very exhausting for a woman to be doing that when you have small children and she's in her 30s and I don't know, like, but I also think I don't know what her schedule's like. Maybe she only works a couple hours a day, you know, and then the father could be with the kids at that time and it might be, I don't know what their home arrangement is, and I think a woman should be productive with her time if she's a mother anyway. Like, a lot of mothers throughout history have had little side jobs they were doing while they were, you know, raising kids. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think that's part of being a productive wife. You know, even in the Bible, it says that
she buys a farm. She considers a farm and buys it or something like that.
A woman takes what a man gives her and she multiplies it. You know, if she's a virtuous woman, she's going to be productive with her time and energy. So I think that's a good thing. But I also wonder about the stress on her as an individual and a mother, and if she's like, because she's also very aggressive in the public eye, and she's
right.
It's a lot of stress to be in that position. So I think she's kind of, I just, looking at it as a woman, knowing women's nature, I just think it sounds like not an ideal situation.
Yeah, I don't think that she should be doing that. But that beta husband, I guess, or a husband who doesn't know better, not much different, I guess.
Yeah, I think they're pretty much the same thing.
Yeah.
And also, what's he going to tell her? Because I can't imagine many men could, like, put their foot down with Candace. Like, I imagine, like, it's probably better she's probably with the kind of guy who's very easygoing and only, like, really asserts himself when it really matters. But
yeah.
It just does matter, because if her energy is taken too much from her children when they're that small, it's going to impact their relationship for the rest of their life.
Yeah.
So,
she does seem, outside looking in, cursory glances, and a lot of those cursory glances and outside looking ins are accurate. It looks like she's on an ego trip.
Yeah.
So it's not good.
And that's a lot of what she does too, because her content is often just like judging other people for, you know, what a mess they are.
Right.
It's not really insightful, like deep, hard hitting. It's not philosophical. It's not.
Yeah.
It's like, look at this person. She's a hoe. Like.
Yeah. Not good.
Mm-hmm.
That's not valuable. It's just adding to hell on earth.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, I appreciate your call, TERRI. Thanks for calling the first time.
Yeah.
Call me again sometime.
Thanks for talking with me about it. All right. We'll see. Take care.
All right. You too. Bye.
Bye.
Some super chats, guys, that I did not get to, as mentioned by some people. Let me make sure. Okay. Shout out to Karen Williams. Okay, at this point, Just Call Me Mike gave me 10 coffees, saying, Dr. Siango, one of the scientists who was fired from Canada's top infectious disease laboratories in Winnipeg, and I mentioned this yesterday, intentionally shared scientific information and provided China with the Ebola genetic sequence in 2019. Triple exclamation mark. Can you go and do a report on that, please? Thank you. And I need to get to that. I don't have it yet at this point. Let's see. Bum, 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 bum. Popcorn's Thump Keg bought a coffee. Caller. Hey, this is John. Most generic name ever. Wow. Don't hate on John. Is that hate? Maybe that's not hate. It sounds dismissive. Don't dismiss the name John. And I live on the West Coast. Hake. Nice, man. Thanks for calling in. What's up, caller? Yeah, I have a sister that lives on the East Coast, and she, Hake, jumps in. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Don't dox yourself, man. P.S. You can't just slap per capita on the end of an opinion or stat and have that add validity. It's not that I'm adding validity. I say per capita, whites are like maybe more fair-minded. Vote Republican as opposed to Democrat. Not that voting Republican is necessarily full-blown sane, but compared to voting Democrat, it's, you know, arguably more sane. Per capita is more sane. The reason I say per capita is because it's just true. Like, the black kids getting in trouble more often, or the Hispanic kids getting in trouble at school more often, it's because they act out more per capita. Per capita, it's true. It's just accuracy. It's accuracy. I also find it somewhat I'm amused by it. I amuse myself by saying it. And it's true. Popcorn's Thump Cake. And it's true. You know that, right? That's a leading question. Do you know that, Popcorn Stumpcake? You don't have to buy a whole coffee to answer my question. Yes, I know that. Or no, I don't know that. You can bring your points. They're great. They're fun. But and I do also like to the whole doxing thing. I use the term a little bit loosely, but it's good and wise, especially if you're like a conservative or an independent thinker or talking to Hake or whatever, to protect your privacy. There's stuff that I don't say, and there's stuff that you shouldn't say, because it's not anybody's business. There are evil people who will stalk you or try to hurt you. Antifa loves to dox and harass and scare and intimidate and violate and even sometimes harm physically with assaults and batteries and stabbing and stuff like that. So, you know, there's all kinds of reasons not to dox yourself. Dox meaning expose personal info. Thank you, Popcorn Stumpcake. Hopefully I explained enough about the per capita thing. You know, like, compared to their share of the population, they're getting in trouble more. Like, 4 times as much black-on-black murder, 6 times as much murder, period, per capita. Per head. They're, you know, that you run into the average black, you're more likely to get assaulted by that black. But maybe that black, there's good chances he won't, but there's also much higher chances that he will compared to the average white. But the average white, there's a chance that he might. So hopefully that explains it. I don't know. I'm trying to explain per capita to blacks. Shout out to the blacks. Be patient with them. We love them if we love anybody. If we don't, then we don't love the whites. It's true. Look into it. Goat biscuit with a coffee, a pithy coffee. Much grass, much appreciated. Muchas gracias. Many thanks, Goat Biscuit. Thanks for your courage, Hank. Well, that's kind. Thank you, Goat Biscuit. Appreciate the support. 3 coffees from Kirkland, who says, what? I got a joke, Hake. 2 black guys die and are awaiting at heaven's gates. Not the cult, but actual heaven in heaven. And the gates of heaven. St. Michael, isn't it Michael the archangel? Says, you are not supposed to be here. The black guys say, yes, we are. Go check with God. St. Michael checks with God, or Michael the archangel checks with God, and God says, oh, because they're black, they can't get in? Go let them in. St. Michael comes back and to God 5 minutes later and says, God, they're gone. And God says, the black guys? St. Michael, the archangel, replies, no, the gates. That implies the blacks stole the gates, because per capita, blacks steal more. They steal more. Man, if you looked at the juvenile justice statistics, let me tell you about these juvenile justice statistics. Let me go look into my black crime. I used to keep... knowledge kind of drives you insane or brings out the insanity. Let's see. Juvenile, Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention Study, DOJ, 2012. Let's see. Federal Bureau of Investigation. Okay, 2012 study by the Department of Justice's Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention revealed that in 2010, because this is when I was kind of interested in this, 2011, it was after Trayvon Martin, I learned from JLP's people, Bond people, including black employees, that black on white crime was higher than white on black and stuff like that. That surprised me, but then after I thought about it, it made sense because I knew that black crime was high. Everybody knows that. 2010, black youths committed 6 times more murders, 3 times more rapes, 10 times more robberies, and 3 times more assaults than did their white counterparts per capita, you know, compared to their share of the population, per head, you know, or per 100 or per 100,000, whatever. Per 100,000 blacks, 10 times more robberies. So there you have it. Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI, also a liberal organization, especially under Obama. This is 20... Oh, no, this is under W. Bush, still a liberal organization. They determined in the year 2008, black youths who made up 16% of the youth population accounted for 52% of juvenile violent crime arrests. Arrests, mind you. So these are not, like, convictedly, but they're arrested for it. Including 58% of arrests for homicide, 67% of arrests for robbery. By contrast, the only categories where white youths surpassed blacks were in liquor law violations. Liquor law violations. And driving under the influence, DUI. And I think that those whites might include white Hispanics, because white Hispanics, which are Hispanics who aren't black Hispanic. And so it's like 63 or more percent of Hispanics are considered white Hispanic. And I happen to know from experience that they drive under the influence pretty shamelessly sometimes. So, and that's from, that source was from American Free Press, Victor Horn article, January 2014, Crime Stats Alarm Black Leaders. So, isn't that interesting? Murder and non-negligent, I don't want to get too carried away in this, but I'm kind of already carried away in it. But let me just read these stats to you guys. Murder and non-negligent manslaughter arrests. Whites, 1.3 per 100,000. So this kind of gives you. Blacks, 6.9 per 100,000. Black youth were nearly six times as likely as whites to be arrested for murder. This is Office of Juvenile Justice Delinquency Prevention, OJJDP.gov. From 1980 to 2012, okay? The rates. Oh, these are 2012 stats, ages 10 to 17. That's what youth means. That's what they mean here. 10 to 17. 6.9 per 100,000, 1.3 per 100,000. Forcible rape arrests. Back in the day, it was called forcible R-word, ape ray. Whites, 6.4 per 100,000, including white Hispanics, mind you. Blacks, 15.4 per 100,000. Blacks youth were more than twice as likely as whites to be arrested for forcible R-word. Robbery arrests, whites, 24.6 per 100,000. Blacks, 270.1 per 100,000. Black youth were more than 11 times as likely as whites to be arrested for robbery. Aggravated assault arrests, whites, 78.8 per 100,000, includes white Hispanics. So 78.8. Blacks, 282.8 per 100,000. Black youth were over 3.5 times as likely as whites to be arrested for assault. American Indians, 67.8 per 100,000. Asians, 26.6 per 100,000. So, that was the black kids of 10, 12 years ago. 14, 18, 30, 40 years ago. You think it's better now? I don't think it's better now. So that's a little bit of black crime stuff for you. Thank you. That's like a serious stuff after that joke about Heaven's Gates getting stolen by a couple of black guys after they died. Amusing, Kirkland. Thank you for your three coffees. TERRI bought a coffee. Suggestion, can you look into and cover the cancellation and untimely death of comic Ed Piskor? I think your show would cover it best given the intersection. A liberal word. Intersection of Me Too, cancel culture, and how it's being weaponized against men. Phony Me Too movement, accusing men and gays of being of R-wording and S-A-ing. Assault. X-say assault A-ing. Me Too. Cancel culture being a banning people for no good reason. Okay, Garrett bought a coffee. Hake, the guy with the good tunes. Not all, but most are pretty spiffy. Especially enjoy when you say, well, I like it. The tone of your voice has a special ring to it. Thanks, Garrett. That's funny. That's amusing. Appreciate your five coffees. It's cool. Amazing Asia. What's up, Amazing Asia? Says the blacks may steal more, but whites eat people more. Is that true? Cannibalism is crazy in your community. Is that true? Eating raw people is really some white people stuff, so she says. I rather someone steal from me than eat me and save me in the freezer for later. Great show, Hake. Are you referring to Jeffrey Dahmer? Jeffrey Dahmer was... Cover your ears, kids. Are they covered? He was gay for the blacks. That's what I heard. According to reports. So watch out. But I don't think that they do. I don't think that they eat people more. You just have the Jeffrey Dahmer. And then there's the Haitians, allegedly, but I don't know if that's true. And then there's people in Africa, and then there's... Remember that guy, that Muslim guy? Aziz? No, Aziz is not his name. There was this guy, Muslim guy who worked for CNN, and he ate a brain, or a bit of a brain, human brain, for... Okay, you can never uncover your ears now, kids. For CNN, when he covered this, you know, this cannibal tribe. So, Amazing Asia, not to get into a competition with you about who does what more, because it's not, you're not doing that. I'm not doing that. You're not stealing. I'm not stealing. So what's that have to do with just because of other people who are whites or blacks or doing wrong things? Thank you. Appreciate the support, the coffee. Yeah, I would rather be robbed and even like assaulted but survive and hopefully not maimed and permanently injured than, you know, like serial killed or mass murdered or you know, killed. I don't want to get killed. But you won't be eaten or in the freezer. Your body would, FYI. You would hopefully be gone from your body at that point. That body would no longer be yours. It was on loan from God. And stealing is much more common, and murder is much more common than eating people. But anyway, that's an example of Hake insanity. Getting caught up with this silly topic. But I want to do justice to the coffee. Thank you kindly. A few super chats, couple rumble rants. That handyman says, insanity is doing the same thing over and over but expecting different results. They say that's the definition of insanity. I've heard that. I don't know if it's a definition, but it is an example of it for sure. Yeah. I was going to say, well, you should keep trying. Donnie Girl's Idea says she could have just stayed on the Blexit message as it is world-changing. Too much ego, says Dawn. Nice. Referring to that woman, Mrs. Farmer. We'll call her Mrs. Farmer from now on. Nobody will have any clue what Hake is talking about whom Hake talks. Thank you, Don. Appreciate the support, that handyman. Very generous man. And, Don? I don't think that that's the only example of insanity, though, that handyman. I kind of like my definitions better in that believing something that's not true. I mean, I get that you can be told wrong information and you just... But you should know that it may be wrong. This information may be wrong. Hake just gave you a whole bunch of information on juvenile justice statistics. That's just statistics. It's incomplete information. It's federal, blah, blah, blah. It doesn't matter anyway. So why get hung up on that stuff? Don't trust Hake. Don't trust anybody. Don't trust your mind's interpretation of the Bible, what you think is common sense. Common sense has to do with living your life, navigating your life, I think. It doesn't have to do with saying, oh, Jesus was emotional because he wept. You know? Or he looked at the Pharisees in anger grieved at their hardness of heart. Because part of that, I say, is thinking you're being like Jesus. That's one example of, it doesn't feel like that's a complete critique of why that's wrong to be caught up in that. Thinking that you know what Jesus was going through. Part of it is leaving stuff blank. Let me move on. Speaking of the Bible, I have some screenshots here. I didn't say all that information was totally wrong. Speaking of the Bible talks about do not be, it doesn't talk about do not be dismayed. That's black. I've picked that up from the blacks. The Bible says, do not be dismayed. Something to that effect, anyway. Okay, let's see. Do not be surprised, it also says. And I've referenced it before. Here's some cross-references that Hassan here is showing. Cross-references to the verse that I looked up. And I'll tell you the verse that I looked up in a second, but these are interesting, too. Ecclesiastes 5:8. If you see the oppression of the poor and the denial of justice and righteousness in the province, do not be astonished at the matter. For one official is watched by a superior, and others higher still are over them. Interesting, huh? That's like the wisdom book, wisdom-related book. Don't be astonished at injustice in the world. Isn't that good advice? And then his other thing about one official is watched by a superior, and others higher still over them. And those people are corrupt. That leaves that part out, but that's what I say to that. 1 Peter 1:6, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in various trials. That doesn't really say anything. As foreigners and exiles, abstain from the desires of the flesh, which war against your soul. Nice. 1 Peter 2:11. Okay, go on to something else. Another one of these screenshots. I'm going to follow Hassan's lead. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though something strange were happening in you, happening to you. That's 1 Peter, I think, 4:12. 1 Peter 4:4. They think it strange, the worldly people, I think it strange that you do not run with them to the excess of riot, speaking evil. Blah, blah, blah. Nice, huh? I'm going to skip that Isaiah one because I don't think it's pertinent. What else? Okay, so this one is the context, and it doesn't say the verse. It doesn't say the book or the chapter, at least. But this is... This is Isaiah. Isaiah 41, I think. Verses 9 through 11. This is God talking to Israel. I brought you from the ends of the earth and called you from the farthest corners. I said, you are my servant. I have chosen you and not rejected you. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will surely help you. I will uphold you with my right hand of righteousness. Behold, all who rage against you will be ashamed and disgraced, and those who contend with you will be reduced to nothing and will perish. Oh, yeah, it says, do not be dismayed. Do not fear. But I've had callers who are like afraid of what's happening to the whites. Christian whites who've been afraid. Older Christian whites. Go down one more. Yeah, I like this one. These are different translations from Bible Hub, okay? 1 Peter 4:12. Let me jump down to one of the ones that you guys like. King James only, anybody? You guys, some of you guys are King James only? I'm not that, but out of appreciation for the King James only people, I will say that one. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though something strange happening to you. The same thing happened to Jesus. The context of that one says, rejoice that you share in the sufferings of Christ. You may be overjoyed at the revelation of his glory. Nice. Some of you guys, though, some of you guys brings dumb stuff on yourself, and then you think you're suffering because you're Christian or because you're righteous. Anybody relate to that? Oh, they hate me because they hate the truth. No, they hate you because you're a hater. You're on an ego trip. Running, you're popping off at the mouth. Anyway. Yeah. But, yeah, so, nice. Don't be surprised at the evil in the world. King James only, says Jasmine. Hey, read the room. I haven't been reading the chat, so I don't know what the chat is saying. 1-888-775-3773. It's time for a break, guys. I will get to some other stories. These federal judges pretending like they're on the Christians' side. It's ridiculous. Maybe evil Obama. But it's Thursday. Joelle Friday TV coming up next. And this is Jens Lechman. A man walks into a bar by Jens Lechman from the 2005 album, I think. Oh, you're so silent, Jens. I hope you enjoy it, you musical Philistines. Be right back for hour two. Hang tight. Enjoy.
A man walks into a bar, orders a beer and a bowl of peanuts, but the bar turns into a spaceship, and the bartender gives him a haircut. I can't remember the end of that joke. You once told it to me when we smoked on your father's expensive cigars. All I remember is the part of a man walking into a bar. How many lovers does it take to put a light bulb into a socket? And why did Mona Lisa smile? I have the answer written down in my pocket. I just remember I laughed till I cried, because you told it with your funny voice. Your southern dialect makes me rejoice. Those special times we had, when love was just a silly gag. I know why Mona Lisa smiled. Da Vinci must have been a really funny guy, and laughter, it's the only way into my heart. I know why Mona Lisa smiled. Da Vinci must have been a really funny guy, and laughter is the only way into my heart.
Shout out to Jens Lechman.
Summer night on a gravel road, you told me about your childhood friend Veronica, who was claimed to have swallowed a toad. Then I picked up my harmonica.
bro, what in the world is this? The singing isn't great, says Chris. This is so good. Hearts. Smiley emoji. Thank you, Pete. I'm with you. I love this track part.
I know why nice. Mona Lisa smiled Da Vinci. Must have been a really funny guy, and laughter is the only way into my heart.
Oh.
I know why Mona Lisa smiled Da Vinci. Must have been a really funny guy, and laughter is the only way into my heart.
Shout out to Jens Leckman.
A man walks into a bar, orders a scotch and a bottle of coke, but the laughter is gone in his heart. You never told me the end of the joke.
I don't think that that was Christian, guys, but it was nice, right? Hey, hey, your harmonica sounds flat, says a Carver. Well, thank you guys for bearing... The song is whack, but he's spitting. This song is generic drug for Xanax. anyway, thanks, guys, for bearing with me. I enjoyed it, of course. So let's move on, guys. You can call in 1-888-775-3773. I have some fun things for later, but federal judges on the Christians' side? I have some screenshots and a clip, 31. Let me show these screenshots. Church's free food folder there, Hassan. So, a federal judge rules in favor of an Oregon church in a key, quote-unquote, First Amendment, First Amendment, the First Amendment, read about it, lawsuit. Hey, Ron here, Ron DeSantis, Ron, I forget what his name is, Hellboy guy, actor, against the city, the small little city getting sued in federal court. Never go to the feds over a local matter. Blacks and liberal fake Christians. Brookings, Oregon, located less than 6 miles from California's northern border. Shout out to NorCal. Hecka. You can't say it. H-E double toothpicks. This is an article by Lawrence Richard on Fox News, March 29th, AD 2024. A federal judge ruled Wednesday, I guess last week, that an ordinance passed by the small city of Brookings and the southern Oregon coast, beautiful Oregon coast, violated the religious freedom rights of St. Timothy's Episcopal Church. Show the next one, number two. And you can see this beautiful red building church thing. There it is. And there's a Google Maps image of it. Look at the picnic tables. Shout out to Oregon and NorCal. Episcopal Church. Episcopalians. Are they even Christian? I know an Episcopalian. His name is Tucker Carlson. And shout out to Tucker Carlson. Even he knows that Episcopalians are barely Christians. They're just liberals. They're just silly people. Shout out to them. Hake is silly too, okay? Go to number three. The church has served free meals since 2009, then took legal action and sued the city in 2022 because the city started cracking down on them. It's a nice looking church building though, hey? And by the way, number four, the city also asked the church to stop shower and advocacy services. They're giving showers to the so-called poor people? Is that what that means? And advocacy? What? Does that mean, like, legal advocacy? I don't know. The church has appealed these directives. Okay, so, dude, according to this article from Fox News, you can go back to the main headline one. And the video is a totally different story, but it's correlates. It correlates. Hat tip to Candace Farmer. If I remember right, I read this article, at least a portion of it, and it said they started doing it 6 days a week. 6 days a week, free food. The neighbors were complaining. I don't blame the neighbors for complaining. You want freeloader bums outside your this beautiful little church thing? 6 days a week? Get it together, people. That's what I say. And with the scamdemic, you know, the shutdowns and all that stuff, that's when they expanded it. Sounds like good work to me, says Falcon Ing. Oh, what's up, Falcon Ing? What are you, some Episcopalian Falcon Ing? Falcon Ing? You don't necessarily... Jesus didn't feed them every day. He fed them when they were out there for a long time listening to him and they got hungry. The church was doing it. Let them do what they want. They should, in my opinion, these people should earn their own food. And this so-called church is enabling them, doing feel-good stuff, enabling them not to, take care of themselves. St. Paul in the Bible says, if a man does not... No, LOL, Falcon Ing is not an Episcopalian. I was joking about that. Joel Friday is scheduled, by the way. Very Christian of you, Hake, says Big Mitch 909. My point, even though the Bible says, if a man will not work, he shall not eat. Churches aren't supposed to be giving you free food 6 days a week? Yeah, maybe they have mercy on you. You get in a pinch. Maybe, I guess. There's nobody poor in America, I say. Nobody's starving. So this whole feed the poor thing, it doesn't exist. That's not the issue. Back in the Bible times, normal people, I heard from one of my Bible study people back when I used to go to Bible study in college, they would get one meal a day. People would get one meal a day. Some of you guys eat one meal a day. I think JLP said he eats one meal a day. So they had actual poor people back then. And even those people who so-called stood up for the poor people, those were phonies themselves. They were hypocrites. Remember that lady, I told this story about the lady who cried and put perfume, expensive perfume on Jesus' feet in like a show of whatever. They're like, what is she doing? The money could have been given to the poor. Phony people. Those were hypocrites. So all this stuff about the poor. And I get the Bible does say, oh, look out for the fatherless and the widow and the orphan and the widow and stuff like that. Having a warm meal served by Christians is good for them, Hake, says TERRI. You would say that, woman, lady, ma'am, miss, ms. I went to Pasadena one time and helped give like a meal to, and Kool-Aid to the poor people, the blacks, so-called poor people, homeless bums, the freeloaders. I'd done stuff like this a little bit. And they were just greedy, no appreciation, and you doing it for also selfishness and ego and stuff. Kool-Aid with a K. So if the neighbors are, if you're being a nuisance to the neighbors and you're, say, think about this, you're a church and you're being a nuisance to the neighbors are complaining. How about being a good neighbor? I am an emotional woman, says TERRI. So that's that portion of the story. Enabling people not to work is not helping them. We're enabling Africa, actually we're killing African businesses, I heard, by giving them free stuff when the people who are making this stuff over there already to sell, they're getting undercut by the free stuff. So you're putting legitimate African businesses out of business. Think about that. Think about these homeless bums or these bums who are living at their parents' house having drugs or having the S word. Doing drugs, having the S word. S. And the mother's like, well, at least they're home safe doing it. You're enabling them. You're helping them. You're encouraging them in that mess. It's not Christian. It's what Christians do, Hake. LOL, lots of laughs. That was the biggest selling point in Rome, was that the poor criminals, women, were treated badly. Just saying, says Kevin Howe. Whatever, man. You're just a cultural Christian. You're a pagan. And I don't say that viciously. It's just that you're supposed to not even be a Christian, right? Aren't you? I thought. Not sure. Hake a Grinch? Quintuple, sextuple, exclamation mark. It's not that I'm a Grinch. It's that I don't fall for this phony stuff. Here's another example. Play this clip, 31. It's a video shows another case in Arizona, another church. Fox News, faux news. Shout out to Fox News. I appreciate them. I like them. And this is a video of a clip from Trace Gallagher's show. He's a reporter, legitimate guy. And he's interviewing this Christian pastor, supposedly Christian pastor, with a thick Hispanic accent and a white, I guess white. He looks like a normal white. Could be fooled, though. But he's a lawyer. So he's a liar. So he might, by profession, he's no longer a normal white, right? Who's representing this so-called Christian pastor in Arizona, where this pastor, quote-unquote, who's on a delay, by the way, could barely speak English. They cast it like it's the government versus the Christians, but listen to who he's feeding. Illegals. People crossing the border, hungry. And so this local mayor, a woman mayor, is suing him or citing him, trying to charge him with different things. Misdemeanors, maybe. Check this out. 3 minutes long.
As we continue focusing on the targeting of Christians, we have another example tonight of a church and its pastor facing fines and possible imprisonment for feeding those who are hungry. Let's bring in the pastor of Getsemani Baptist Church in San Luis, Arizona, Jose Manuel Castro, and First Liberty Institute Senior Counsel Jeremy Dice. Gentlemen, thank you both. Pastor, first to you. They keep threatening to fine you. In fact, they are fining you, threatening to charge you if you don't stop feeding the hungry because you're bringing in these truckloads of food and it violates zoning. Will you stop doing this, Pastor?
Well, Pastor. I would like to not stop. I need to continue feeding the poor people and the people in needs.
Yeah, and Mr. Dice, it's interesting because the lawsuit says although the church disclaimed that any of its operations were currently illegal and committed to rectifying any potential issues moving forward, defendants refused to even discuss a solution that would allow the ministry to continue, even resorting to citing the church's pastor for passing out food to just a few hungry people. Why are the churches being targeted for doing what they believe is right?
I sure wish I knew why Mayor Nieves Riedel has targeted Gethsemane Baptist Church and its incredible ministry of feeding the hungry, especially those who are crossing the border right now. Throughout the region, people who are without food are coming to this church for food. This has been a longtime ministry of this church where the city has in the past embraced this ministry and encouraged it. But once Mayor Riedel became the mayor, she put an end to that whole mixture. And now the pastor has been cited and fined two different times. If he's cited one more time, he faces the potential of misdemeanor criminal charges as well. All this for having the audacity to feed hungry people. Because of Mayor Riedel, people tonight are going to bed without food in their bellies. Pastor Manuel is ready to not only feed them, but to care for their souls as well. This mayor and this city should be encouraging people who are feeding the hungry rather than fining them and threatening them with worse penalties.
Yeah, and Pastor Manuel, why is it so important that you continue this in the face of what the city is doing? Would you just stop for a little bit or are you going to continue?
Well, I would like to not stop to doing this ministry. I hope God make a miracle and the attorneys make a work and help us to fix and make solution on this situation, because we would like to continue and serving our community. We have a lot of needs in our community, yeah. A lot of poor people, a lot of needs.
Yeah, I've got about 20 seconds left for you, Jeremy. Is this a fight you think you can win?
Absolutely. The First Amendment is clearly on the side of Pastor Castro and the good people there in San Luis. Mayor Riddell needs to take a step back and remember what this Constitution, this First Amendment is all about. Yeah. It protects pastors and churches just like this all across the country. That's why we're so committed to this at firstliberty.org.
Pastor Manuel, Jeremy Dice, gentlemen, thank you.
I disagree that this is an attack on the Christians. Very eloquent, says Tom Bell. I would like to not to stop. I like that accent. It's not full-blown American, exactly. But it's... What did he do wrong? My opinion, he's feeding the illegals. He reminds me of Glenn Beck and Ted Cruz. And shout out to those two guys. But they're soft-hearted rhinos, in my opinion, sometimes. They gave teddy bears and soccer balls to the UACs, unaccompanied alien children, about 10 years ago under the Obama invasion. Obama allowed all these illegals to flood the border, these underage illegals, unaccompanied alien children, minors. They're not necessarily children. They're like 14, 15, 16, 17 sometimes. Maybe a little bit younger. They were flooding the borders and they wasn't stopping it. And so these do-gooder, phony Christians were enabling it. Enabling it. And Ted Cruz, Glenn Beck giving them teddy bears and soccer balls. Makes me want to spit. To have Trump throw paper towels out to them, Ivana says. Yeah, Trump threw, like he was shooting hoops, paper towels to the, and had fun with the, what were they? Puerto Ricans, maybe Puerto Ricans. And liberal Trump derangement syndrome sufferers were thought that he was being disrespectful. Get based. They're doing good. This guy's not doing good. Wait, they were feeding illegals. What the? Yeah, they were feeding illegals. People crossing the border, the lawyer said. Feeding illegal aliens. Helping them come. They're like, oh, we're finally being treated as humans. Remember that story that I told you guys about that little shop of... Did I tell you guys about this? Little shop of kindness up in New York City. Bunch of volunteers, mostly white or Jewish probably, giving free stuff to these people. Free clothes because they don't have a change of clothes. They get bussed over there to New York. That's why I'm not exactly for this busing stuff. I understand there's some good and bad. I would like to not to stop. Hake has to CID before serving soup to the poor. No soup for you. I'll be the soup Nazi. And these federal judges are siding with these people. Federal judges siding with them. Federal judges don't side with you unless it's something liberal. So it's not as these local communities trying to get some order in their community, not have these worthless bums freeloading in their area. It's like attracting flies. Now, I get that they're human beings, of course, but it's like attracting like the elements that you don't want in the area. And the church has no regard for that because the church doesn't have to suffer from that so much. They get treated well because they're giving them stuff. Anyway, let me move on. Joe in Phoenix, Arizona is on the line. You can call in 1-888-775-3773. What's up, Joe? Thanks for calling and holding there.
Good morning, James.
Hey.
You do know that Obama deported more people than more illegals than any other president, right?
No, I don't know that.
Yeah, look it up.
No, I'm not interested. I won't look it up.
Okay, well, that's just a fact.
It's also a fact that he allowed unaccompanied alien children to come unrestricted. So here, there's an alternative fact for you.
Other president.
There's an alternative fact for you. So you can ignore my fact and hold on to your fact and stay
and
insane.
You can do the same.
Yeah, I'll do the same.
Do the same.
Yep. Because Obama's evil and you pretend he was good.
I really don't understand why you say he's evil.
Because you're evil. You're blind.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. You know you're evil, but that's all right.
Nice. Glad we came to an agreement.
Yeah.
Came to an understanding.
Well, we've known what we thought about each other for a long time.
Go ahead.
Going back like a couple of weeks, William called in. And William, I have a huge respect for you. You're an intelligent man. We need more black men like you. But you were confused as to how 51% of black men could be single and childless when the out-of-wedlock birth rate is over 70%. I don't know if you remember that call or not, but that 70% out-of-wedlock birth rate is a yearly stat. And there's only about 500,000 black babies born every year. So that's 1 million total, or 500,000 black men, 500,000 black women having babies per year. So 70% of that is 350,000 men, 350,000 black women per year.
Yeah, so it's not like they're making a whole bunch of babies. Oh, they a lot of them are, but they're aborting more per capita. And then there's also all kinds of ugly birth control stuff going on too.
Yeah, I mean the black birth rate has been declining for years now.
Yeah, especially the black American birth rate. The black immigrant birth rate is higher, and so it's making it look like it's not declining. They're not at replacement rate, right? Black Americans, correct me if I'm wrong, they're a declining population, black American natives.
Correct, for the last 20 years, yes.
Wow. So they're kind of like the whites.
So that's why they were saying, oh, the math doesn't add up. No, the math adds up just fine.
Right, it's just it's completely different, unrelated statistics. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yep.
There you go. So that's really all I had today. But
isn't it a shame that that they're having fewer babies?
No, I think it's a good thing long term, actually, because, again, you know that I place a lot of the ills at the feet of these new feminist Oprah nonsense feminist black women because they're the ones who decide who has sex and they're the ones who decide when babies get born. So they need to choose better and black men need to be smarter about who they're having babies with.
Huh. So you sort of remind me of my caller yesterday, Denny in Bulgaria, who's fine with these lazy bums relying on their parents and on the government because then he knows not to have to deal with them. And so these immoral blacks, it's better that since they are immoral, that they're not having children.
I would agree with that, yeah.
But I argue that if they were having children and not enabled to be irresponsible about it, meaning they had to be married, they didn't get welfare, stuff like that, mm-hmm. They would rise to some more higher level of morality or higher ethics. If these people weren't enabled by their parents to not to work or enabled by the government not to work, they would be forced to work and build better self-respect on some level and dignity and be working and become better quality people.
But that hasn't been working now.
It hasn't been working only because we've been enabling it, you know, with the welfare and stuff. Right?
Well, again, James, there are more white people on government assistance than there per capita, James, than black people.
I'm not even talking about the black versus white thing. You're changing the subject. I'm talking about we're enabling people not to be responsible by welfare and all that stuff?
Well, welfare is supposed to be a temporary hand up, not a lifestyle. But again, you know, the poor black community, which is what causes the problems, what causes, as you say, the problem people. Those folks, you know, I think it's a good thing that that population is declining. Yeah.
I know, but that population could become could be forced to become better by not helping them. So this hand up thing, most of the time, I don't really believe in this hand up stuff.
Oh, yeah. I mean, supposed to be a ladder, to help themselves, not just a lifestyle. But, you know, it's a complicated issue. We could talk about it for hours, but I just want to clarify the out of wedlock birth rate thing. I'll let you go to talk to somebody else. But you have a good day, James.
All right, you too. Joe in Phoenix. Bye. I hope just quickly, just so as not to get a click. He doesn't click me, though. It's just like with this feeding the poor do-gooder stuff. These phony people. A super chat from Popcorn Thump Keg. Coffee, I won't argue with you on the crime stats that you cite. I will, however, say that you yourself have said that statistics come from statisticians. Statisticians are liberals, and liberals lie. And when you are asked to cite your sources and you don't have one, your escape hatch is generally, you mean you don't know that XYZ is true? It's not, I get that it can be used as an escape hatch, but I'm interrupting his super chat because it's not pithy. But I don't begrudge him his non-pithy super chats, necessarily. But look into it for yourself if you're truly interested, you know? I found out by looking into it. And you can find out by looking into it. Great resources are Real Vincent James, Jared Taylor, The Color of Crime, American Renaissance, Amren. Colin Flaherty, if you can find his stuff. Rest in peace. He's why I say LOL lots of laughs. I say it out of kind of a nod to him, the late, great Colin Flaherty, because he used to read LOL lots of laughs. And I found that amusing, by the way. Look into the Bureau of Justice Statistics, Criminal Victimization Survey, look into the DOJ, FBI, all that stuff. And if you can understand, you're a computer science guy, I think, not to dox you, but I think you can kind of understand rates, look up the populations, differences in populations, and look into it. And it's really like also kind of shocking and surprising to me when people act like they don't know that black crime is out of control. And I don't know if you were one of those people or not. So just curious about that. Popcorn Thump Keg continues, Oklahoma's violent crime rate is 458.58 offenses per 100,000 people. New York has a violent crime rate of 363.76 per 100,000 people, because they have a whole lot more people. Does that ring true to you? Which is another measuring stick I've heard you use. Yeah, I think it does, because Oklahoma has a lot of blacks, I think. And it's more sparsely populated, right, in general. New York has a whole lot of, like, Jewish people and whites in upstate and whites in New York itself. And so they're not, when you have a whole lot of people, probably the percentage of blacks compared to this and Hispanics in Oklahoma, maybe a higher percentage than in New York. So that could be the reason. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's a higher percentage of blacks in New York than Oklahoma. I could easily look it up, but I don't want to take the time to do that right now. But it's certainly quite possible. A lot of the liberals like to say, oh, the red states, and they cite states that have blacks in them. Like, does Tennessee have a Republican governor? But Tennessee has Memphis and Nashville and black crime-ridden cities, right, has higher, you know, violent crime or whatever, gun crime or something. I'm like, okay, but if you account for the black population, they have the higher violence. So, yeah, I mean, it's, I don't dispute it. If you're going to advocate for people being individuals and thinking for themselves, then treat everyone as an individual and give them the benefit of the doubt before you make any determination about them. You use the term risk assessment a lot, but if the only thing you know about an individual is their race and that sets off your risk assessment senses, you're not dealing with them as an individual. Yeah, you are. Yeah, you are. And that's not the only thing, because there's a black nerdy looking guy, or there's a black old elderly lady, there's a black young man, and the black young man, they get mad at you for thinking they're going to get violent towards them, but they have stolen, and they know they've stolen, they can't help it, blah, 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 I get it. No judgment from me. Or if there is judgment, that's my problem. But you, it's not a determination, it's a risk assessment. You just keep your distance a little bit. It's dangerous times, popcorn stump keg. And the kids of all races going out of control and leading the way, the black kids. I encourage you to check yourself that you're bothered by this at all, if you are bothered by it. Because you're not one of them. You're not one of those people, but you're hung up on this like Joe from Phoenix, I think. Thinking there's something wrong with me for noticing something wrong with the blacks when everybody knows there's something wrong with them. So thank you for your coffee. Appreciate that. Another coffee I think I saw from Carver. Hake, did you pick up on this? That free food thing from the story earlier is called Gethsemane Food Ministry. Gethsemane, Gethsemane, get some money, hiding in plain sight. The Garden of Gethsemane was where Jesus went and sweat blood or cried blood or something. He was stressed. Get some money, get some money. Interesting. A lot of these churches are all into these numbers and all that stuff. Oh, we need to bring numbers in so they do free food and stuff. It was a trick. It was a ploy in the Christian clubs, too. And my friends would go and enjoy the free food and then be, like, bored during the talk and the singing. Although they did like that that song, Shout to the Lord, because it sounds like, who is it, Brian Adams or somebody? There's some similar songs from those slow jams. IG, what's up, IG? Sorry I'm sad 2014. Says, hi, Hake, listening to your opinion over African Americans, meaning black Americans, saddens me. I watch this show because it says Christian-based. Nice, right on. What opinion do I have about so-called African Americans? I don't think I have opinions about the blacks. I don't think I have any opinions. I just have, I guess you could call an assessment an opinion and some factual information. But why are you be sad about, don't be sad. Sorry, I'm sad 2014. Thank you for joining. I missed it. Shout out to Aguilar and CLC and the people, anybody watching over on IG, Instagram. TheHakeReport.com for other ways to catch it. Jay in New Hampshire is on the line. Jay, thank you for calling and holding there, man. What's up?
Hey, question for you. Since, you know, you believe in a globe Earth, right?
I know it's a globe.
Okay, if you know it's a globe, right?
It's obvious.
I would like to know.
Yeah, yeah.
If the sun and the moon both rise in the east and set in the west, how is it we're supposed to look northeast at 3 something for an eclipse. How did the moon surpass the sun? Just curious if you globers could explain that one.
Because
the moon supposed to come out after the sun?
No, the moon comes out at different times, all different times of the day.
Yeah, but it's supposed to rise in the east and set in the west.
Does it?
How can it get in front of, just like the sun?
I never noticed that. See, flat earthers know more than Hake.
Oh, boy, you should wonder how, if they both rise in the east and set in the west, how is it the moon can get in front of the sun if it's a globe, buddy?
Because the moon goes at a different rate from
No, they're equal. One goes down, one comes up, right? They're 12 hours apart from each other.
No, they're not.
Supposed to be.
Nuh-uh.
Yeah, that's how you have day and night, my friend.
How do you figure? Sides,
if the Bible says, right, if the Bible
have you ever
says
seen, have you ever seen a moonless night?
Very rarely.
But you have seen a moonless night.
Sure.
Then that means that the moon doesn't go at the same rate as the sun. The sun is in a totally different place.
Get to see the moon every other night or something like that?
No, I'm not saying every other night, but every so often you don't see the moon. You see the moon during the day sometimes, during the night sometimes, not at all sometimes.
I would love to see globers explain the moon, you know, how and when we get to see it then. That would be awesome on a globe.
Because it's going around the Earth. Right? It's orbiting the Earth. And then also we're spinning. The Earth is rotating or whatever.
I know.
How do you explain
it every day?
How do you explain it?
Because we're stationary. And I was also curious, you know, if you believe...
We're stationary, but you didn't explain anything.
Okay, so the moon, for one, right, is supposed to be, the Bible actually calls it a lesser light to rule the night. So how can one light block another light? That always makes me curious as well, because the Bible doesn't say it's a solid object. It says there's a greater light that rules the day and a lesser light that rules the night. I wonder if eclipses could be man-made. Never know.
Oh, man. Insanity. So you didn't explain anything then?
I don't know. You still didn't explain how if the sun and the moon both rise in the east and set in the west, how does the moon get in front of the sun?
Because the moon moves
after.
The moon is moon is closer to the earth than the sun is, right?
Okay.
And the moon moves at a different rate across the sky from what the sun does.
But the rate that you're explaining, that you sometimes don't see it and that you do see it, that moon would be like screaming across the sky to try to catch up for the next day since it's not rotating at the same time as the sun.
How do you figure?
Have you ever noticed?
That's not a logical statement.
I urge you to check this out. When you have your solar
glasses
on,
you didn't explain
right?
anything, though.
If you should look to see that the moon and the sun, without its shininess, when you're looking through the glasses, are actually the same exact size.
I don't know if that's true.
You can measure it. You can check it out. You can look it up. That's been done.
Interesting if true, but I don't know if it's true.
And if they're the same size, how are they different, miles away from...
Because they're not actually the same size. They just appear to be the same size because the moon is much smaller but much closer, and the sun is much bigger but much further. You know how something looks smaller?
Sure. Yeah. I completely understand.
So I've explained.
It appears that we're not moving too.
No, it doesn't. It appears that we are moving.
Have you ever actually seen a 3D model of what it actually looks like with the globe explanation of things?
Yeah.
With everything ripping through the galaxy, spinning around and everything, but yet you're supposed to stay with the same North Star not moving at all, and you look at the same constellation?
Right, and we can see the North Star in the Northern Hemisphere, but the Southern Hemisphere can't see Polaris, right? Or is that true?
So... How is it our rocket, like our spaceships, right? Once they exit Earth, they're now in the nothingness, and Earth should be flying, 66,000 miles an hour?
Why are you jumping from thing to thing and not even explaining
kinda,
a thing?
I am explaining things actually very well.
You have not explained anything.
Sure. You say there's gravity on Earth, right? And we can't feel the spin.
Because it's been spinning forever. It's been spinning since you were born.
All right. So when spaceships that only
have
go
you ever
like,
felt it
you
stop
know,
spinning?
What, Mach? What, well, listen, Mach 8 or whatever the Mach 12 isn't as fast as the Earth is ripping through the universe. Okay, is what supposedly. So how is it when they go into outer space that they can catch back up with the planet that's like going to be leaving them in the dust?
What?
Like, they're just common sense questions that
wait,
people
what?
Don't
wait,
really
wait,
pay
are you referring
to
people who are you referring to airplanes? I kind of zoned out. I was
no,
looking
spaceship.
At the chat. Oh, a spaceship?
Like a spaceship. Yeah. When it leaves the planet, right, and goes into technically what they say is outer space.
Yeah.
The planet's now ripping through, like, bye-bye, but yet they can come back to the planet when they can only go like Mach 10 or Mach 12, but the planet is supposedly going like 66,000 miles an hour. How can they catch back up if it's real?
What do you mean catch back up? Once you go into the atmosphere, once you get into the firmament
No, I'm saying out of the firmament.
I know, but once you get back into the firmament, once you break back into the firmament, you're going along with the firmament. The whole firmament is
yeah, but if you leave
orbiting.
The firmament, the Earth is now leaving you at 66,000 miles an hour. How do you catch up with your slow plane that
because
can't go that fast?
You're following alongside it.
Not anymore.
It's called
you
orbit.
Left it.
Have you heard of orbit?
Sure.
Orbit
but
is
no more
falling.
Gravity pull for them.
It's not pull. Gravity is not a pull. It's a push. I heard. I don't know if that's a relevant
okay,
point.
So you're still not being pushed. In the nothingness.
Yeah, no, you're being pushed towards Earth. Some of the flat
you think
earthers
gravity
are saying...
Then you think gravity is a push or pull, doesn't matter. You think gravity is now pulling you back to Earth once
pushing.
You left it in a spaceship?
Yeah, you're not gone
just,
from gravity.
I just want you to ponder some more things. That's all, buddy.
But
I
you haven't given
little,
me anything to
little,
ponder because you can't. You haven't even explained anything.
You haven't explained how the moon... gets in front of the sun, and when they both rise in the east and set in the west.
Yeah, huh?
I'm asking you to explain that for me.
Okay, let me explain it. Let me explain it for the third time. The moon goes around the Earth. Our perception.
At what
right?
rate?
At a different rate from how the sun does.
I don't. What rate? That's just a theory.
I don't have to tell you a different rate. If you know that the the sun is out during the day, right?
Sure, I would hope so.
And so the moon is out during sometimes the day, sometimes the night, sometimes not the night.
Yeah.
So that would tell you that it moves at a different rate. So since they move at a different rate, at some point the moon is going to get in front of the sun.
That's assuming that you think that they go around and not in a circular motion but over a flat surface. I'm not saying they don't rotate in a circle.
I'm not assuming it's obvious. It's an obvious
all
globe.
All the way around.
Anyway. I appreciate you, Jay, in New Hampshire. Even the chat was saying you're jumping from points to points too much. You got to calm down.
That's okay. I still want Globers to explain how the moon with the speed and all these things, since it's so common and so easy to understand, I would love like all the people in the comments start posting.
Did you understand
exactly
my point?
How that moon gets in front of it. Oh, I did. I understand.
Then I don't understand your misunderstanding, except that you're like blind insane.
It's all good.
Hung up on a point.
Anyways, man, God bless you guys.
You
man.
Too, man.
Run.
Shout out to the flat earthers. I love the flat earthers. If I love anybody. Oh, you got me with a click. Moving on. Jeff in Louisiana is on the line. What's up, Jeff in Louisiana?
How's it going, man?
Going well.
Okay, you go on and on about the homeless all the time. I want to read you two verses from the Bible. And one of them, it says, Proverbs 19:17 says, whoever is generous to the poor lends to the Lord, you repay them for the seed.
Say again?
Whoever is generous to the poor lends to the Lord. He will repay him for the deed.
All right.
I mean, that's what I'm saying. Try to help the homeless. I mean, I'm not saying everybody, but, you know, everybody just coming from Mexico or wherever they come from just to get here to be homeless.
Are the homeless poor?
Yes, they are.
Poor in what way?
They don't have a home. They don't have a... Most of them don't have a home, don't have a job, don't have food.
And that makes them poor?
Okay, let's say Jesse fires you right now. You can get money coming in.
No, does that make them poor? not having a home or a job or food on hand?
Yes, it does.
Are they going hungry?
If they're poor and can't afford food, yes, they're going hungry. If they're begging for food,
do you know anybody? Have you ever met any homeless who's actually going hungry?
I've seen a guy this morning driving down the road outside begging for food.
Begging for food?
And
he was given food, right?
Huh?
He was given food, right?
Yes, I was given food.
No, somebody else gave him food, right? Have you ever heard of a homeless starving to death in America?
I can't point to an individual story. See, that's what you try to point.
I'm telling you, these people are not poor. They're,
never mind.
You can,
man, I called you little Jesse. I'm going to stick that by.
All right, bye. He gets frustrated very easily. No patience. My point about the homeless is a lot of them are bums and dishonest and thieves, and all of this stuff is enabling. I don't know. Get that through your head. Do you disagree with me about this enabling point? Anyway, let me double check any other remaining super chats that may have come in here. Over on buymeacoffee.com/thehakereport, Amazing Asia says, whatever the earth, whether the earth is an obvious globe or not, or not so obviously flat, it doesn't matter. The blacks are still going to steal and the whites are still going to eat other humans. Laughing face emoji. Have a great day, everyone. Yeah, that's the big picture, Amazing Asia. And you, not you, Amazing Asia, you, the general you, are still sinful, miserable, prideful, insane, angry, and a bum, whether you're homeless or housed. Whether housed or unhoused, we have a whole bunch of bums. The bum pit. Nah, the snake pit. Thank you, Amazing Asia. Speaking some sense. She black. Noah's Ark Kansas donated a generous donation over on Streamlabs. Thank you, Noah's Ark Kansas. Nice to hear from you, man. Shout out. Let me double check over on Streamlabs. Shout out to the Beta Legs, Misty, Noah's Ark Kansas, GMD Jim. I think that was from yesterday. Cactus Eater Bear for the ice cream and lemons. And Jake Hudson for hosting Hake over on DLife. That's cool. Okay. I don't have much time left. Do make sure that you catch Joelle Friday TV coming up here. Joelle after Hake. Nick, the American Anchor Baby, after Hake. Let me play this. I do have time for this. Evil Obama. Clip 33. Barack Obama writes, and I read this already. In your 20s, you might not know that the Affordable Care Act, that's Obamacare, blah, 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 blah. You can stay under your parents' health care plan until 26. Evil Obama. Proof, Joe from Phoenix, that Obama's evil. Right here.
Before the ACA, young adults could be kicked off their parents' health care plan.
Based.
Often right when they were getting ready to head out on their own. And if you had a pre-existing condition, the same companies could deny you coverage. They could charge you more.
Yep. Nice.
So the ACA changed all that. Now health care plans are required to let young adults stay on their parents' plan until they're 26.
That's not that
Insurance
young.
Insurance companies, they can't deny somebody coverage or change them simply because they have a pre-existing condition like diabetes or asthma. So all that stuff's important because while young people are generally pretty healthy, all it takes is one diagnosis or one injury, one accident to throw off your plans if you don't have insurance. And thanks to the ACA, young people everywhere have some security. They have some freedom to choose how they live their lives.
That's
really what the ACA is all about. Now, like any freedom, we can't take this one for granted. Right now, the presumptive nominee for the Republican Party for president says he wants to repeal the entirety of the ACA, and that would mean kicking millions of young people off their parents' health insurance,
yes,
raising costs at a time when a lot of folks are just starting out. We can't let that happen. We've got to keep building on the ACA, expanding coverage, lowering costs for more people. We've gone too far to come back, and that's what Joe and Kamala believe. That's what they've done while they've been in office, and that's why this election is so important.
What a phony guy. A complete phony. He said that it's freedom, and he also said at the end of his tweet that I read to you yesterday or whenever it was, maybe 2 days ago, healthcare isn't a privilege, it's a right. This is not a good impression of him. Healthcare is not a right. I've already said that. It's maybe a need. It is not a right. That's communist talk. That's mama talk. And that's not freedom. Freedom is freedom to fail or succeed. Because he's violating the freedoms of these companies to discriminate against you if you have a pre-existing condition. Say you have a pre-existing condition that they can't afford to cover, they're going to go out of business. Or a whole bunch of people, it adds up. A whole bunch of bums on diabetes. Some people are not diabetic because of bumhood. But some people are bums because of diabetes. I gotta go. It's time for me to end. Raising costs, subsidizing stuff raise costs. Trump is not gonna let people die in the streets. He already said that. He doesn't want people to die in the streets. So Trump knows how to make stuff cheaper and make you thrive more. Or help you get out of the way, get the world out, get the business out of the way so that we can thrive more. I gotta end. This is Huntington's no pool party tonight. Diabetics are bums. Adios, America. 1999 album, Get Lost. Joel Friday next. Ramones clones.
No pool party tonight. No pool party tonight. No pool party tonight. There's no pool party tonight. No pool party tonight. No pool party tonight. No crabs, no cheese.
Pool party. Swimming pool.
I'm a cutie girl tonight. Now and later it's all the same. Cause we won't be here to take the blame. I guess I'll call my girl for free. They grab some chips for me. Well, I don't mind a little crowd that doesn't like to get real loud. Cause all in all I know we'll be alright. But there's no pool party tonight. No pool party tonight. No pool party tonight. There's no pool party tonight. No pool party tonight. No pool party tonight.
Pool party, swimming pool. They're like the Ramones clones.
No pool
party tonight. No pool party tonight. No, no pool party, oh no. No pool party, oh no. No pool party, oh no. No, no pool party, oh no. No pool party, oh no. No pool party, oh no.
Adios, America. Do well Friday next. I'm late.